Good evening and welcome to our Wednesday night prayer meeting and Bible studies. Tonight we have a lot to give God thanks for. We have been lifting up our pastor for some time now in prayer, and we're happy to report that his surgery went well. And he's back home now recuperating. And we just want to continue to lift him up in prayer, because we serve a God who is a miraculous God, a God of miracles. And we just want to continue lifting him up and pray that he will have a speedy and successful recovery. We also want to keep in mind those who have requested prayers and those who are facing difficulties at this time. And we also want to lift up those who are sick. So we're going to start off, I'm going to start off tonight's prayer. And after, then anyone who wants to pray, please feel free to unmute your mic and to join in. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just want to give you thanks, Lord, for everything that you have done for us. I want to give you thanks, Heavenly Father, for taking us through the day. I want to thank you, dear God, that we have come to know you in such a mighty way. We pray, Lord, for your forgiveness of our sins and all our unrighteousness as we lift up your holy name tonight, as we come before your throne of grace to lay before you all our cares. I pray, Heavenly Father, and we give you thanks for our pastor, dear God, and for the operation that you have brought him through. We'll give you thanks, Heavenly Father, for the miracles that you will work in him as he recover. We pray, Heavenly Father, that he will have a speedy recovery. And pray, dear God, that he will not have to perform this operation again. You are the all-healing God. And we know, Heavenly Father, that just one touch from you, he will be healed. We pray, Heavenly Father, for those who are experiencing difficulties at this time, dear God, whatever they may be. We pray, Heavenly Father, that they will find comfort in you. We pray, dear Lord, for those who are sick. Pray, Heavenly Father, that you just continue holding them. Brother Mills, Heavenly Father, I pray, Heavenly Father, that you continue touching him, dear God, as he hold on to you, Heavenly Father. We pray, oh God, that you hold on to him, because we know, Heavenly Father, that once you hold on, there is no letting go, there is no slipping. So I pray, Heavenly Father, that you continue blessing him and keeping him, dear God. We pray for the members of Valley Stream. Will pray for our pastors, dear God, that, and their families, that you just continue being with them. We pray, Lord, as we go through this night, Heavenly Father, and look forward to our Bible studies, we pray, Heavenly Father, that you'll open up our minds to receive your word, and that our heart will be fertile soil for your word to be sown. We pray, Heavenly Father, that as we learn more about you, we pray, oh God, that it will continue to be reflected in our lives, so that wherever we go and whatever we do, dear God, we will exemplify Christ. We thank you, oh God, and we give you thanks and we give you the praise. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen.
Father God, we thank you for the cornea transplant. Thank you for the doctors that that have laid their hands on my father's eyes. We thank you for Brother Elijah as he drove my father to the doctor. We thank you for the church family. We pray for the people that have the coronavirus, that they'll be able to get out the hospital. And we pray that my father will be able to see once the eye patch is off. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Anyone else? Just jump right in.
Dear God, we give you thanks and praise for your goodness, Lord. I am so grateful to you, Lord God, personally for what you have done in my husband's life, Lord God. Only you understood, Almighty God, the trial, the struggle, Lord God, for months now as his eye continued to deteriorate, his good eye continued to deteriorate. And Lord God, I know that he kept a lot in just to not have to lay that burden upon anyone, especially us. But God, he was able to lay it all on you. I know that there were hours in the night and there were early hours in the morning when he was up talking to you, because I know, Lord God, personally, that he talks to you like you are his friend. And that, God, he has always taken time out, Lord God, to have that time, that one-on-one with you, Lord God, and just to pour out his heart to you. And I know that there were times, unbeknownst to us, when he said he was okay, but he was probably on the inside just getting weary, Lord, and just wondering, Lord, will I not be able to see again? But you are a faithful God. And so, God, we just want to thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you that you love us more than we love ourselves, Lord Jesus. And you know us better than we know ourselves. And so, God, we just pray, Lord God, that you will just, that this one will work, Lord, that his body will not reject it, but that, God, you can keep his immune system in tow, Lord God, so that it will not reject this one. It will not see it as foreign. It will not see it, Lord God, as an invader, but that, God, it will see it as a part of his body. You created man, Lord, and you know how the system works, and you know what to do, Lord Jesus, and how the body needs to communicate to itself, Lord God. And so, Lord Jesus, I just pray that you will touch him in a special way. Lord, I know he is grateful to you. Lord, thank you for everything. I pray for others who are sick, others who are waiting for their breakthrough, for their miracle occurrence, Lord. I pray that your will be done. Lord, I pray that you'll touch Brother Mills in a special way. Touch every part of his body, Lord, from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. And for others, Lord Jesus, who are sick, others who are grieving the loss of loved ones, those who are grieving the loss of jobs, whatever the situation is, we know you can intervene. We give you thanks and we give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Father God, we pray for my father's eyes, that they'll heal and that he can see and drive again. And we pray for Brother Elijah, that you'll bless him. And we pray and we thank you for him taking my father to all his appointments. We also pray for people who are sick, that they won't get sick anymore and that they'll get better. We pray for everybody who are sick, who are waiting to get better, and that we have problems. In Jesus' name, and amen.
Amen.
O Lord, O Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. Father, tonight we humbly bow at your feet to give you praise and thanks and to bless your holy name. You're a merciful God. We love you, we worship you, we adore you. You are great and greatly to be praised. You are the all-powerful God, the ever-present God, the God who never changes. And tonight, Lord, we can say thank you. We thank you for Dr. Clark. We thank you for bringing him out after his surgery. And I pray that it will be successful. Lord, you instructed us that we should pray one for another. And you said the effective fervent prayer of the righteous man avails much. Father, you sent and heal our diseases. We know you are the miracle worker. And we know, Lord Jesus, that we are going to depend on you and we're going to rely on you, Lord, and we're going to stand on your promises and pray. Father God, you know all things best. Pray that he will not now suffer with pain. Dear Father God, if there's any pain, we pray that you will alleviate those pains or discomfort, that he'll be able to sleep. We pray, Almighty God, that his healing may spring forth speedily. And we thank you. We pray for Sister Nadine and the children. We pray that you may continue to cover them under the shadow of your wings. That you may continue to bless them. And that you may give Sister Nadine the strength to stand by her husband. We pray, Almighty God, for Sister Doreen, whose son is lying in the intensive care unit. Father, we pray that you will intercede for the life of her son. And we pray, Almighty God, that you will increase her faith, believing that what you lay in her heart concerning her son. We pray for Dwight tonight, dear Father God. We pray that you may continue to touch him from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet, physically, spiritually, and emotionally. We pray that you may touch him with your healing power and give him restoration of health. We pray that you may give the medical team and the doctors the full, instruct them, dear Lord, and guide them in his care. We pray for Sister Lorraine and her family, Sister Allison and her family, as they grieve the loss of a loved one whom they are preparing to funeralize. Lord, may you comfort them and give them inner strength and inner peace. We pray, Almighty God, for the leaders in Valley Stream Baptist Church. May you bless them all and guide their footsteps, their emotions. I pray for the pastors, Pastor Hutchison, Pastor Anthony, Pastor Mills. Dear Lord, may you bless them as they continue into the ministry and guide them. We love you, we worship you, we adore you. I pray for all my sisters and my brothers and for all those who are sick. We continue, dear Lord, pray that you continue to touch their bodies. I pray for all my sisters and my brothers in Christ. Let us hold on to Jesus. Let us stay with our Lord, for he knows. He listens and he acts upon all those who believe on him. I pray, Almighty God, that you will continue to open your windows of heaven and pour your blessings upon us. And tonight I pray that you prepare our hearts to receive your words. And I ask this in the precious and mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Amen. Anyone else? Just unmute yourself.
God, we pray for Daddy that his new cornea will work and it'll get healed. We pray for Sister Doreen that son, that he'll be able to get out of the hospital and be well. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
O Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. O Lord, we praise your name. We praise your name, Father. God, we give you honor, glory, and praise, Father. God, you are so awesome in our lives, Father God. Father God, we give you we give you the highest praise, Father. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, the miracles that you continue to work in our lives, Father. Father God, I just want to give you all the praises, Father God, because God, you are so grateful. You continue to spread your grace and your mercy. You continue to allow your grace and mercy to be upon us, Father God, from day to day, Father God. We know, Father God, we could be in different places, but God, because of your love and your mercy and your grace upon us, Father God, you protected us, Father God. You are our rock of Gibraltar. You are our fortress. You are the life. You are the sunshine of our life, Father God. You are the great physician, the sympathizing Jesus. And Father God, tonight, I just want to just thank you for the fact that God, you took our past into surgery, and you took him out, Father God, alive in one piece. And Father God, for that, we are so grateful, Father. God, we just want to just thank you. We cannot do and must work, Father. God, we just want to just thank you for our church family as they continue to be concerned and to rally around our pastor and other members of the church, Father God, who are sick. God, we just want to just lift them all in unison, Father God. They are so numerous, Father God. Those who has lost loved one, Father God, tonight we just want to just ask for comfort for them, Father. God, we just pray for strength. We just pray that, God, you will just give them the strength at this time that they need, Father God, to deal with your situation. Because, Father God, it's not easy when you lose a loved one, especially in time like now, Father. We pray that, God, you will just build a fence around them, Father God, those who mourn. God, strengthen them, Father God. Those who are sick, Father God, we pray for that your Holy Spirit will abide with them, Father. I will just thank you for everything that you do, God. We just pray, Father God, for our pastors, our three pastors. I will just pray that as they take over the mantle in this time, Father God, that you will just strengthen them, Father God. Give them the boldness, Father God, to dispense your word with clarity. And in a manner, Father God, we will all learn from it, Father God. We just pray that, God, as we continue to support them, Father God, that, God, we too will be like a sponge, Father God. We will absorb the word, and, Father God, we too will go out into the world and spread the gospel, Father God, that people will see you in us, Father, and come to know you too as Lord and Savior. Father God, we know that, God, without you in our lives, Father God, we will be doomed, especially in times like this in our country, Father God. We know that it is so depressing, Father. But God, as we know that when we look to the world, we are so depressed and distressed. But Father God, when we look to you, there is so much light, there is so much joy, there is so much peace of mind, Father God. And we pray, Father God, as we seek your face, Father God, that we will purify ourselves, Father God. Help us, Father God, to truly set ourselves apart, Father. Help us to make sure our calling is an election, sure. And that, Father God, we will put ourselves on the path to righteousness, Father, because you want us to be righteous, Father God, because your word said that the devil comes to kill and to destroy, but you come that we may have life and have it more abundantly. And Father God, tonight we just want to just give you honor, glory, and praise, Father. We want to just thank you for everything that you do, Father God. Those who do not know you, Father, we pray, Father God, that they will just look around and see the miracles that you wrote, Father God. You can see the beauty of this world, see the beauty of the sky, the trees, the birds, everything that is around, Father God. And those who also do not believe in you, Father God, they will also see you for your handmade, Father. God, tonight we just wanna thank you for everything again, Father God. We cannot thank you enough, Father God. You are awesome in our lives, Father God. We just continue to give you honor, glory, and praise, Father God. And God, we just want to lift up this country. We just pray for the leaders. We pray that God, you will just touch their brain, Father God, touch their brain cell, because Father God, we do not know who's in charge of this country, but God, whatever it is, Father God, we pray that you will put a stop to this pillage. Continue to bless us, Father God, tonight as we prepare to hear your word, and we pray that Pastor Anthony will do justice with your word, Father God. We know, Father God, that he's capable, and we just want to just pray that God, his word will be your word, and that when we leave here tonight, Father, that we will not be the same. Continue to bless us and guide us. In your name I pray. Amen.
Okay. Anyone else?
Most holy, righteous, and eternal Father. Lord, I thank you for this another privilege of coming into your presence. Lord, I thank you that you are the never-changing God, that there is indeed no shadow of changing with you, Lord. As you have been in the beginning, even so shall you be unto the end. Lord, I thank you tonight that you are the Lord of the heavens and the earth. Lord Jesus, tonight I just want to thank you for your word. Lord, the word that became flesh and dwelt among us. I pray, God, that by your word, Almighty God, we will be transformed, Lord, into what you would have us be. That your word will cleanse us, wash us, purge us, O God. I pray tonight, Almighty God, that you will continue, O God, to lead us and to direct us in the path of righteousness. Lord, tonight again, I just want to thank you, O God, for the miracle that you have performed today on our pastor. Lord, indeed, you are the great physician, the sympathizing Jesus. Lord, the one we can count on. Lord, the one we can rely on. Oh God, I thank you. And tonight, God, as he is home recovering, I pray in the name of Jesus that you will give him a speedy recovery. Lord, I thank you for his family. Oh God, as they stand by him, I pray that they will find strength in you, Jesus. Oh God, and they will be encouraged, Almighty God, as the days go by. But tonight, I just want to pray, Lord Jesus, for the pastors that you have placed, oh God, in Valley Stream Baptist Church to lead us and to guide us in the way of truth. Lord, I pray in a special way tonight, Almighty God, for Pastor Hutchinson, Lord, who is moderating this Bible study. Father, I just pray that you will continue to bless him. Oh God, bless his family as they support him in this ministry. Lord, I pray that he will grow in maturity, Almighty God, from day to day. Lord, Pastor Anthony, I lift up before you tonight and his family. Oh God, he loves you, Jesus. I just pray tonight, God, that you will anoint him afresh. Oh God, even from the crown of his head, Lord. the soles of his feet. Oh God, I just pray tonight, Father God, that you will use him, oh God, in a mighty way, in a special way, as your vessel, oh God, that will dispel your words to us. Lord, I thank you for those of us who are online here, oh God, as we come together in this fashion. Just want to thank you for this platform. Lord, I just pray, Almighty God, that you will continue to bless us and to keep us steady and focused upon you and not to be distracted by what is happening around us. But Lord God, we as believers, God, we know that these things are expected. Oh God, all that is going on around us are expected, Lord God, as time draws closer to your return. So Father, help us, oh God, to set our minds, oh God, on heavenly things. Lord, the things that are permanent, the things that are eternal, oh God, and not on earthly things that fade away and just last for a moment. Lord, remember those who are out there on the front line, oh God, battling this pandemic. Lord, I just pray, Father God, that you will give them a word, that they will understand that they need you. Lord, there's no way, oh God, they can fight this by themselves. But we need the supreme being, the stronger power, the anointed one, oh God, to rule, to direct us, oh God, as we continue with this pandemic. Pray for those who are sick and recovering. Lord, I pray for those who are shut in. I pray in the name of Jesus tonight, God, that they will reflect upon you, Almighty God, and what you have done for them. And Lord, that you will bring healing to them and strengthen their bodies according to your will. So we pray tonight, God, that you will give us receptive hearts. Oh God, just help us, Father, not to be complacent with what we will learn tonight, but that we will act upon it, whatever is given to us through your words, that we will act upon them, Almighty God. We will sow the seeds, oh God, and we will live the life, we will walk the walk, and others will see you in us and want to be like us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen. At this time, I just want to say thank you for everyone who prayed. And at this time, we will move right over into our Bible studies with Pastor Anthony. And at this point, we'll just go into one song, after which Pastor Anthony will join us.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul.
I worship your holy name.
It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever we pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul,
oh
Sidney. His holy name.
Sing like
never before. Oh, my soul, I worship
your holy name.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
We praise the Lord. Praise the Lord tonight. We praise the Lord. We give honor and glory to God. I know that a lot of us, there's a lot of rejoicing tonight. Amen. Tonight in the Lord. I am rejoicing. I just remember I was sitting, you know, around in the office, and I got the call from Dr. Clark, and my heart just rejoiced. And I know a lot of us that you have been praying, and we know that prayer changes things. Amen. We know that prayer changed things. And I just want to just give God all the praise and the honor and the glory tonight for this great breakthrough. You know, as Sister Nadine prayed tonight, and we, they, you know, the aphorism said that all who feels it knows it. Amen. And the man of God went through the surgery, and it is truly a blessing, you know, just to know that it was successful, and we just rejoice in the Lord. Sometimes we are afraid to give accolades, and it's not that we are lauding men, but, you know, as brothers and sisters, we just have to continue to encourage each other. And just this week, I just remember that my wife sent me a text, and she said that I was celebrating my 11th year as an ordained minister. But I want to go to a passage tonight, and just to encourage everyone, just to let you know that it is okay. Amen? As we lift up Dr. Clark tonight, as we continue to say thank you for the sacrifice that he has made to this local body. And I just want to go back and tell you that it is okay. Because in Job chapter 1, verse 8, the Bible said this, and the Lord said unto Satan, this was the Lord unto Satan, and he says, hast thou considered my servant Job? But watch this now. He said that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil. Amen? So I just want to use this time just to say, Dr. Clark, thank you. Remember, 14 years ago, you joined this body, Valley Stream Baptist Church. We pray. And we pray to God, you know, for a man, a man to send a man. And God send you. And tonight, I just want to let you know, Dr. Clark, you have never ceased to dispense your word, the infallible word of God. And I'm going to say to you tonight that God is well pleased. Amen. And I just want to say this, that you have made a very great impact on my life. You have shattered, based on the word of God. The word of God has shattered a lot of doctrinal beliefs that I had early, that I grew up with. Amen. But as knowledge, as we receive knowledge of God's word, there's a lot of things that's going to happen in our lives. Amen. So I just want to personally say thank you, Dr. Clark. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for your commitment. And most importantly, Dr. Clark, I just want to say thank you for your obedience to the Lord. God is well pleased with you, my brother, friend, and pastor. Amen. God bless you. Amen. For those of us who are joining us for probably the first time, we are on page 20 of Understanding Prophecy. And before we do anything, I just want to go to the Lord in prayer as I spend these few minutes with you on this study. Father, I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord God, for this great opportunity and this great privilege that you have granted the Heavenly Father unto me. I pray, Almighty God, that everyone, the Heavenly Father, that is viewing by way of Zoom land this time, Lord God. I pray that everyone, the Heavenly Father, that is tuned in at this time, that Father, you grant them, Lord God, a special blessing, Lord God. I pray, God, that they will walk away, the Heavenly Father, oh God, filled, Lord God. I pray that, Lord, that they will walk away, the Heavenly Father, with something from you, the Heavenly Father, not about me, Lord, but it's about you. So, Father, right now, the Heavenly Father, sensitize every heart to your word. At this time, Father God, any stumbling block, Lord, remove it, Father, in the name of Jesus. Any plans, the Heavenly Father, of any man or the enemy, Lord God, Father God, to stand in the way of your word going forth, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray, Almighty God, that you take full control. Father, thank you in advance for your blessing. I pray, Almighty God, that you be glorified throughout these few minutes, Lord God, that we meet the Heavenly Father to give honor and glory to your name. Thank you, Lord God, for your word. Because, Father, we know, Almighty God, that it will never, ever go back, Lord God, into you void, Father, but it will accomplish its purpose. So, Father, we thank you, Lord God, for tonight. Thank you in advance for your blessings. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen and amen. Once again, on page 19, now we are at page 20 of this study. And we are talking about the foundation at the beginning, part one. If we do not know where we are coming from, we will never, ever be able to understand where we are going. Amen. We will never be able to understand where we are going. And we are at this understanding prophecy, the future foretold by the past. And we are on day four, the foundation at the beginning. And of course it is, we're talking about the foundation, and the foundation is the structure. Amen. It's God's structure. It's the skeleton that is in place to prepare us for what is to come. Amen. I want to pretty much just turn to a passage in Isaiah 46 verse 10. And I'm going to turn to that passage with me as I commence tonight's study. Isaiah 46, and I'm looking through it as I go along, and we look at verse 10 of Isaiah 46, and I just want to read just that one passage for you, declaring the end from the beginning. And it's very important for us to understand where I want to go with this. It said, I am declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. That's Isaiah 46, verse 10. I am declaring the end from the beginning, from the commencement of time. I'm declaring the end from the beginning. So I know that Dr. Clark mentioned a lot last week about the beginning and what happens at the beginning. And in order for us to understand prophecy, we have to start from the beginning. In order for us to understand God's redemptive work, we have to start from the beginning. If we are out to understand prophecy, then we have to understand what is God doing. So tonight, what I want to do for these couple of minutes, I want to paint a picture tonight. And I'm going to paint this picture from Genesis chapter 1, and I'm going to look from verse 6 to verse 24. Prophecy, we're going to look at prophecy. What is this Genesis 1 account all about? There are many theologians and many schools of thoughts. They come with a lot of things that God is just, Genesis chapter 1 is just about God's activity in creation, and the other who talks about restoration. But what is the purpose for this restoration? Why he had to restore? And all of this we have to come to an understanding of tonight, and we have to start from Genesis, the foundation. We have to understand what this is all about. Genesis chapter 1 makes it very clear. And in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, right? And as was mentioned last week, what happened is that we see that, and I'm just I'm touching a certain point just to paint this picture, and I just want to start just to give you a few things that we spoke about last week so we can refresh and we can move straight into the actual study. So what happened? We understand what happened in the beginning, that there was creation before the beginning. Of course it is. There was a perfect world, and we know that something happened, and Ezekiel chapter 28 laid this down for us, and what happened, and the enemies act in what transpired, which caused this to happen in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 and 2. So in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth was formless and void, and darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God, the Bible says, was moving over, watch this, very important, moving over the surface of the waters. So what I want to do is paint this picture. I want to paint this picture tonight, and just to remind you that the book of Genesis establishes truths about God among those in the first book, the first book of the Bible. I'm not going to touch Genesis chapter 3 verse 15 as yet, because there's a lot of things that we can take from this verse. As a matter of fact, in the New Testament, there are 44 prophecies that Jesus Christ fulfilled. And the first one is the Genesis chapter 3 verse 15 account, and that was fulfilled in Matthew chapter 1 verse 20, Galatians chapter 4 verse 4. And what happened is that we received a handout, and all the prophecies that Jesus Christ fulfilled, it's laid out there. So I'm not going to spend just for time. I'm not going to go through. But I want you to just go back and relate to the handout that was given. The Messiah, Genesis chapter 3 verse 15 tells us that the Messiah, of course, would be born of a woman, and we understand that account, and hopefully if I get some time that we can touch a little on that topic. But I want to move in and go straight into the passage. So if we go back on page 20, right? Genesis chapter 1, then God says this, and Dr. Clark did Genesis chapter 1, and he did the first day. Day 1, what happened in day 1? On Genesis chapter 20, page 20, God says this, let there be light, and there was light, right? And so a lot of us who did the notes, there is a foundational themes that there is a blank page at the back where you can make reference to. I like to give credit to the writer, so you can make your notes whether there are not. Or for those of us who went ahead and make your notes, then we can follow, right? But just touching day one again, that on the first day, God brought forth light. He made a separation between light and darkness, and he called the light day and the darkness night. And if I could stop, we could just use that verse, and we could relate that a lot of things to man, looking at the regenerate man and the man who is the who was generated. Amen. The unregenerate man and the man who was generated. We can relate that. Hopefully, I can get an opportunity to speak on that tonight. Amen. But that's the first day. So what I was about to do, I was about to scan through all these dates, day one, day two, all the way to day six. Because I said that, you know what? Yes, we have read this several times. We know what this is about. But I was stopped in my track, pretty much. I was stopped in my track. Why? Because everything that God placed in his word, it has significance. There is significance to everything. And I'm telling you that each of these days, that is mentioned in scripture, they all have significance. Amen? We're going to go through each day. And once again, as I said before, if you made your notes already, then we can go through. And we're going to go through that as quickly as possible, because I want you to paint this picture. So imagine this. Just imagine this. In verse 6 of Genesis chapter 1, we're going to the second day. This is what God said. Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters. And God made the expanse and separated the waters which were below the expanse from the water which were above the expanse. And it was so. And God called the expanse heaven, and there was evening and there was morning, a second day. So this is the second day. So what happened is that here's the expanse. The expanse was in the midst of the water. And God says this, let us separate. So there was water above, there was water beneath. And what was the expanse? The expanse was in the middle, because this is an order by God. God orders, spoke this into existence. That we know about three heavens. We know about the atmospheric heaven, the starry heaven, and the heaven where God resides, right? We know all of that. So if we look at the picture, and that's what I want you to do. I want to paint this picture, right? We're going to paint this picture. I want to paint the picture tonight, right? Where are we going? Are we talking about restoration? We are moving from restoration to redemption. That's what this is about. Restoration to redemption. So watch this now. So the expanse was in the middle, and God said, let the waters go above. Then the expanse in the middle, which it Bible tells us here that the expanse was the heaven. God called the expanse heaven. And there was evening and there was morning. So we have the expanse in the midst of the water. It was separated from the water. And the expanse, as I said, was heaven. That's the second day. Everything that has significance. Throughout scripture, we know that if I bring a man into the picture, man, as we know, and through this, you're going to see God mentioning separation. Separation. He separated this from this, and he separated that from that. Where man is concerned, even for man to be regenerated, there had to be a separation, because man was in darkness. The man, Adam, was created, made in innocence. And what happened is that we know what happened in the creation account, that what happened is that Adam, as we know, he fell into sin due to disobedience. Amen. He disobeyed God, and that caused a separation. Amen. And bear the separation in mind. In order for us to be a part of the spiritual body of Christ, there had to be a separation. Why there had to be a separation? There had to be a separation because every man, woman, boy, or girl who was born, and let me just say man is neutral gender, so every man born after Adam, we know that what happened is that they were born spiritually dead. They were separated from God. Why? Because of Adam's sin. So there is a separation. So throughout, we're going to see a separation. But why the separation? Let's continue. Before I paint the picture, once again, as we go through, get the picture. The first picture that we see here is what? Is God casting light into a dark, void, formless, ruined creation. And God cast light. Amen. And there was light. And then God caused a separation. And now God separated the waters. And then in the midst of that, there was the heaven, the expanse, the atmospheric heaven. Bear in mind, once again, that God, he has a reason for doing everything. Every word in scripture has significance. Every chapter, every line in scripture, it has significance. Let's move now to day three. Once again, in respect to the writer, then God says this, now let the waters below the heavens, amen, be gathered into one place. Get the picture. Let it gather into one place, and let the dry land appear, right? Let the dry land appear. And it was so. And God called the dry land what? Earth. Amen. And the gathering of the waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let the earth that just came into existence, let the earth sprout vegetation, right? So we see the expanse, right? We see the waters. Now we see dry land. And then God now starts putting things in place. putting the dry land and vegetation in place, plants yielding seed and fruit trees bearing fruit, and let God start putting everything in place. Come on, don't lose the picture, because we're going to get back there. And why am I getting all this picture? And the earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed after their kind, trees bearing fruit. What is this? What is this about? With seed after their kind, and God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. Paint the picture. Darkness, after darkness, what happened is that God created, there was the waters, then the waters were separated, and redeemed the waters from up and from and below. Then God made the expanse, which is the heavens. And here it is now, God poured all the water below, and he made those seas. And in the midst of that, there was earth. And then God started cultivating on the earth, so bringing forth things on the earth. So what do we see? We see life form start taking place now. Life form start taking place. Amen? So we go on page 21, and we're going to still continue. Page 21, the foundation at the beginning, part 2. You see what happened here? Genesis is setting the stage for the rest of the Bible. It's setting, Genesis is about the world, sin, and salvation. And we're going to see this as we go along, the foundation upon which the remainder of Scripture rests. It starts from the beginning. Get the picture in your heads. Think about this as we go through. This is where God begun his revelation to man. God start bringing on this formless earth. He starts shaping things, and what he's doing now life is coming. Plants and vegetation is coming on the earth now. So let's go to Genesis chapter 14 now. Get the picture as we go along. Get the picture. Then God said, watch this now. Let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be for lights in the expanse of the heaven to give light on the earth. And it was so. I want to stop here just a little bit. The light that God, we're talking about the moon, we're talking about the stars, right? We're talking about things that gives light on the earth. So what happened? What was God's intent for these things? It's to light the earth, amen, to bring light on the earth. But what do you think men start doing even today? Men start worshiping these things. Men still looking and talking about sun god and moon god and star god, and they worship astrology. That wasn't the intent for those of us. I want to shut those beliefs tonight. Those of us, we look in astrology and we start reading the stars and we start relating them to our personal lives. And some of us, we can't leave home without listening to horoscope. What man is saying instead of going, what was the purpose of these things? The Bible tells you exactly what these things were. What God says it was. It was in verse 14, let there be light in the expanse of the heaven to separate the day from the night, and let there be the signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be for what? For light in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth. It was a source of light. It's not for worship. It's serious today. The different religions and the different things that we are caught up in. I want to encourage the people of God tonight, the body of Christ. I want to encourage you tonight. Let's look at these things. Let's take a fine teeth comb and comb through these things. They all have significance. But what happened? Did you know that all the plagues in Egypt, do you know that all those were gods so-called that they worship in Egypt? All of those, the flies and all that, you know, those were all the Egypt worship Egyptian gods, so to speak. Yes. So we see here the reason why God made the moon and the stars. The reason for those And it's specific. It is specific in scripture the reason why these things, he spoke these things into existence. God made the two great lights. He specifically said the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night. He made the stars also, and God placed them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth and to govern the day and the night and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. Amen. We need light. God knew. Watch. Don't lose the picture as we keep going. Fourth day, light in the expanse of the heaven to separate the day from the night, signs and seasons, days and years, light for the earth, sun, moon, and stars. It was specifically to light the earth and to bring and for signs and seasons and everything. And then we move to Genesis chapter 20. And I'm not rushing through, but I just want to let you know that these things, they all have significance. Amen. And it's going to come back. It's part of what's going to happen as we move in through prophecy. Then God said, let the waters teem the swarms of living creature. Amen. Let it teem the swarms of living creature, and let birds fly above the earth in the open expanse of the heavens. He said, let those things happen. And God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarmed after their kind, and every winged bird after the kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply and fill the waters and the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth. And there was evening and there was morning, the fifth day. There's God's restorative work. God is in the business of restoring earth. But look how this is going to relate to man, right? Then we go now to the sixth day. Then God says, let the earth bring forth living creatures after their kind, cattle and creeping things and beasts of the earth after their kind. And it was so. And God made, watch this now, God made the beasts of the earth after their kind, and the cattle after their kind, and everything that creeps on the ground after its kind, God saw it that it was good. Now, the picture that I'm seeing is that here it is, that the world, the earth now is flourishing. You see, the earth is flourishing with water and plants and light. And God, look, and God says that it was good. It was the fifth day. But watch what happened in verse 26 now of Genesis chapter 1. Something changed. It switched right here. Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. And let them rule over the sea and over the birds of the sky and over the cattle and God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them, and God blessed them. So what happened here is that throughout, God was speaking everything into existence, doing this and doing that. And then, here it is, verse 26 of Genesis chapter 1. God now said, let us make man. What I want to point out to you tonight, why is it that God says, let us make man after he created everything else? That's the question tonight. What is it? What is it? What's the purpose of God creating these things? Now, you have to understand, take into consideration initially what happened. Initially what happened, the first creation in the beginning, right? It was there in perfection. Then something happened. It was damaged. So now what is God doing? God is restoring. It's a restorative process that God is going through right now. He is restoring this fallen creation, this formless and void creation. But he put everything in place. And hear what God says now. He says, let us make man. So he placed man in the midst of this. In the middle of this, he created man. You got to understand that man is a principal part of creation. We go back. Why was man created? God had a plan. And the plan was that man was going to rule this creation. But where does this come from? Why man? First of all, who was the ruler of earth? That's what we want to find out. Right? We know that Satan, he was the ruler. He was placed in that position. But what happened? He went and wanted to go against God. So as a result, what happened is that Satan, he was disqualified. So here it is now, because Satan was disqualified, God placed man in the scene. Man was placed on the scene. So what do you think Satan is doing now? Satan intend to disqualify man. But the question tonight is that was he successful in disqualifying man? We're going to prophecy. Was he successful in disqualifying man? Absolutely. He was successful. He was successful in disqualifying man. And because he was successful, what happened is that man who was placed in the garden to rule, to carry on God's business, what happened is that Satan disqualified him. And what happened? His disqualification caused man to be separated from God. Look at the restoration. God had to restore a broken creation. So here it is. What does God have to do? Now, because of disobedience, God had to restore man. Man was separated from God. And God had to restore man. So the same way that God is restoring this creation, God had to restore man in the same way. We had to be restored, because if we are not restored, we will be eternally separated from our God. We will be eternally separated from our God. Just like Satan is separated from God. Guess what? He was disqualified. He lost his position, because what happened? He want to be in the place of God. And even today, sisters and brothers, man want to be in the place of God. God is restoring man to that position. It started in paradise in the garden. And guess what's going to happen in the end? God is going to bring that man to that same position in paradise. So this is the work. It started here. This is where it started. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. What happened is that man in God's image, we are talking about now man has knowledge. Man, we talk about rationality. We're talking about the power to make decision. We're talking about righteousness and true holiness. Amen, somebody. We talk about Job here first when I was giving accolades to my pastor teacher. And what happened is that we have to understand is that man in the image, we are given the power. God give us power as man. The Bible said that he blessed man. God blessed man in verse 28. God blessed man, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and rule over the fish, rule over every living thing. And God said, behold, I have given you, watch this, every plant yielding seed that is on the surface of the earth, and every tree as fruit yielding. So this is it, man in the likeness of God. Sisters and brothers, let me say this, that God in his act, in his restorative work, we have to understand that God, he understands, because of his omniscience, he knew what man was going to come up against. And what we see here in the entire creation story, what we see, it was God making provision to receive man. But what is God doing? If we look throughout scripture as prophecy unfolds, what will we see? We will see little bits and pieces that God put together. I never forget, I have an account where I remember my wife, and my wife, when she was pregnant with my daughter, what happened is that I was away, and when I came home, she put some clues together. And she placed little clues here, and she placed some clues there, and she placed some clues over there, and I had to start from clue number one. And I moved from clue number one, and then I couldn't leave that clue number one until I go to clue number two. And what happened? She led me right to that pregnancy test that says that she was pregnant. Why am I bringing this up? God, there are bits and pieces that we have to put together. But how are we going to understand what is going on? How are we going to understand how to live? How are we going to understand God's prophetical work? How are we going to understand these things? We have to take the bits and pieces. And I said, the Bible says that, listen, your precepts from precepts, line upon line, a little here, a little there. We have to come and we have to put all of this together. So this is an encouragement tonight, just to encourage you in the Lord. So listen, in God's restorative work, He knows exactly what He was doing from day one to day six. He knows. And I'm stopping at day six because day seven is a totally different study that will take the entire time. But I want to stop at that. This is the last day that God, six days that makes sense. And what happened? Because God was preparing for man every step of the way. Through His omniscience, He knew everything that was going to happen, that the devil would disqualify man and that man would need to be restored. So what God was doing before He made man, we could see step by step. We could see man need life form, man need food, man need light, man needs, I'm talking about needs now. If you look, those are needs. Even the animals are there. And today, what we do with animals sometimes, we use animals, and we use animals to make clothing. We use animals to eat. We eat, we make food. Some people, transportation in some countries. Amen? So we see everything in place. So what I want to do, I want to paint the picture. That's what God was doing. God was making provision to receive man into this world. And what happened is just like you purchase a house and you have children. And if you have children, what you will go and buy furniture for the house and furnish the house and the children. All they have to do, they come in. And what they have to come in and do, they come in and occupy the house. God was furnishing earth every step of the way, as I read from verse 1, from Genesis, from chapter 1 all the way to chapter 31, we see where God was furnishing the earth, and that was making provision for man to live. Man needs oxygen to live. Man needs food to live. Vegetation was there. Man needs water. All the things God put in place. And you know what? I read this over and over. And, you know, just to get in depth and realize that this is what God was doing. God was making provisions to invite man, to bring man into this place in order for man to inhabit. Amen? And that's what we see throughout this. So we look at it and we see that God, the sixth day, in verse 31 of Genesis chapter 1, He says, "And God saw all that He had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning." The sixth day. And it says, "And now for the seventh day," page 22, "and now for the seventh day." Read the first verse of chapter 2 and make notes of what the seventh day was all about. We're going to go through the seventh day another day. Amen. But as we go to Genesis chapter 2, I just want to wrap this part up for you. Is that now, this is what it says. It's another two have made notes. And of course, I talk about the foundational timeline. And for your personal studies, what I want you to do, you can go and you can take the foundational timeline, which is on page 25, and you can fill it out just in your own words, You know, if you don't want to use your notes, so you can go and make reference and go back to this. So we move to look at paragraph number two, and it says, what you have now is the foundation. And this is going to move to something very important. What you have now is the foundation upon which the remainder of scripture rests. So from here on, you just received the foundation, and everything that happens after here in scripture, this is where it started. This is the start of it. It rests on everything, and this record of event given at the very outset of God's revelation to man is specifically laid out with the divine intention of revealing that to man certain things that God's plan for this age and the age to come. This was God's planning. First of all, there had to be earth. And then on the earth, there has to be inhabitant. And God placed man on the earth to inhabit the earth and make provisions for man to live on this earth. So this record, divinely ordered as it is, it captures the very perfection of God's timing, ways, and means of restoring a ruined creation. So God is an on-time God. He is strategic. He specifically, look at God's order. Look at the order. From formless to a wonderful creation. From a ruined creation to a beautiful, a paradise. Amen. That's God. Anything that God made it perfect. Amen? Since God performed a restoration perfectly the first time in any subsequent restoration of a ruin, he would only employ his previously established timing, ways, and means, having deemed it perfect the first time. Absolute perfection cannot be further perfected. Amen? First of all, I want to let you know this. That God's intention is for you and I to walk in perfection. Adam and Eve, created and made in innocence. But God's intent, amen, was for them to be perfect, amen? And that's why specific instructions was given to them is that, listen, I'm placing you here. And guess what? I'm giving you everything for your comfort. I'm giving you everything to survive, for you to survive. But guess what? I'm going to tell you one thing, this one thing. Do not touch this fruit, this tree. Anytime you touch it, guess what happened? You will die. But what happened? Do you think it's more about the tree? Today is the same thing. It's about obedience. You disobeyed God. Amen, somebody. What happened is that we disobeyed God. Even today, we will suffer loss if we disobey God. And I'm talking about suffer loss even in the physical. Amen. We'll suffer loss walking, because guess what? The enemy is, what is God's intention? God's intention is for every man, for everyone to enjoy this salvation that he has given us. God wants us to enjoy this. But what do we do? The enemy wants to rob us of the joy of our salvation. That's why what David said, Lord, restore to me the joy of my salvation. God made in the garden, God made the provision for man to enjoy everything, to take charge, to rule over everything, to take charge there. But guess what? Disobedience robbed them of the bliss. Disobedience robbed them of the peace and the joy that God intended for them. Today, sisters and brothers, as we walk in this world as Christians, guess what happened? As we've been shaped, what happened is that is why in James chapter 1, the Bible said, listen, he says, count it joy when you fall into temptation through trials. Count it joy. And the joy that you should count is to know that God is with you, and God's intent is for you to enjoy life. God's intent is for you, sis and brother, even in those times of stress. The joy that we feel is that we do not walk alone. The joy that we feel is that, listen, God promised that he will never leave us nor forsake us. The joy that we feel is that he walks with you. The joy that we feel is that he talks with you. He stands with you. You are never alone. And I want to remind us and encourage us tonight as we continue. Then with the creation and subsequent fall of man, along with the resulting ruin of earth due to man's fall, what happened now? God begins, watch this now, God begins another 6-day period. He begins another 6-day period of the restoration to bring order out of resulting curse brought about by man's fall at the hand of Satan. So there was now another 6-day restorative process. But what we saw first, we saw 6 days of God restoring creation. Now what are we seeing? We see God's redemptive work. So now, because of man's fall, God has to redeem man. So we saw restoration, which God is now restoring man through redemption, which can only come through one person, and that is the person of Jesus Christ. One person of Jesus Christ. So we see here that, guess what? This time, the accounting of each of the 6 days of restoration will be 6,000-year days, not 24-hour day. We can make reference, we don't have much time, but 2 Peter 3 verse 8, with a 7-day rest. So what do we see now? We see it is a 1,000-year period at the end of 6 days, which is 6 1,000-year period. And as we go through the study, the writer is going to expound more. As a matter of fact, in the next day, which is lesson chapter 2, day 1, we're going to see that the writer is going to build on this. First of all, your takeaway tonight is that first, God was restoring a ruined creation. Amen? Ruined creation. Creation that was made perfect, but what happened? It was ruined. So here what happened, God had to restore that creation. Sisters and brothers, look at man. Same thing. Man separated from God. So what God had to do with man, first God had to restore this formless and void earth, and now God is restoring man. God is restoring man now. But this will take what? It will take a 6 1,000-year period. And then on the 7th, what we will see. So let's wrap this up. The foundational timeline laid out in Genesis 1, 2, 2, 3, based upon the timing, the ways and means God initially employed in restoring a new creation, it becomes the skeletal framework, watch this now, upon which we can build in order to understand how the subsequent restoration of a ruined creation will take place. God created man. Man was ruined, and now God is now restoring man to his position of rulership. How must that be done? Once again, Jesus Christ is the only way. So in the foundation, Genesis chapter 1, we read here. We see the skeletal framework. What happened? We see a foundational timeline. And once again, as we move into scripture, we're going to get an opportunity to see that. And we're going to get deeper into it as we continue on this study, the foundation of the beginning, part 2. Understanding prophecy, the future foretold by the past, part number 1. Sisters and brothers in Christ, stay encouraged. There was a promise as we look at the 44 prophecies with Genesis chapter 3 verse 15 being the first one mentioned. we see that Christ made a promise. And this is what we as Christians, we walk on. The Bible made specifically, God made a promise that first of all, that the enemy will be crushed. Amen, somebody. The enemy will be crushed. Sister and brother, there is war right now. There is war right now, right? Because what happened is that Satan knows that his time is coming to an end. And what is he doing? He is making sure that my sisters and brothers, that you and I are disqualified. Over and over, he disqualifies us before the Lord. Over and over. But I want to remind you at 1 Peter chapter 8 as I close today. It says we need to resist the devil. We need to 1 Peter 1, 9 say, fight the good fight. Because we have to understand that Jesus, our Lord and Savior, he will come and the enemy will be crushed. Let us walk in assurance, sisters and brothers. Let us stand and refuse to be disqualified. Let us intentionally put up that fight to resist the enemy and refuse him from disqualifying us. And we can only do that through knowledge of the word of God. God spoke it into existence, sisters and brothers. What happened? And God promised that he's not going to leave us and he's not going to forsake us. Tonight, I want to thank you all for just coming and just be a blessing. I just want to encourage you all in the Lord. Stand firm in the Lord, sisters and brothers. I want to make one comment as I go along. Sister and brother, let me tell you something. Do not be distracted by this coronavirus that is going around. I never had the opportunity to speak to you about this, but don't be distracted. Stand in God. Go back, and as we meditate in God's word, stick to God's promises. His promises is true. God is not a man that he should lie. And he said he's going to take care of us. Whether you're sick or not, just remember that, listen to me, that Dr. Clark is a perfect example. That, listen, the enemy can do whatever with the bodies, but there's a part of you, my beloved sisters and brothers in Christ, that the enemy cannot touch. You are sealed in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let us walk with that assurance. The enemy can take away everything that we have. He can take you and destroy us physically. But let me tell you something. We are secured in Jesus Christ. And that is why we walk by faith and not by sight. I love you tonight. And God loves you. Best. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for your blessings. Oh, God Almighty, you're an awesome God. It brings joy to my heart, Lord. Thank you for the joy that I felt today, Lord. And Dr. Clark made that call and said, Pastor Mills, Lord, I was thinking, Lord, that he would probably be asleep, but he called. Strong voice, Lord. God, is nothing that he has done, but Lord, it's because of you strengthening this man of God. Father, let our people, Lord God, your local body, Father, oh God, let our spiritual body, oh God, let us rejoice in you, Father, as we see, oh God, you take charge and you do things in this world, dear Heavenly Father, to us, Father God, but Lord, we can rejoice, Father, we can rejoice in your miracles and your assurance. Thank you. Just for who you are. We love you, Lord. May the Lord continue to richly bless you. Thank God for tonight and thank you for listening. May the Lord bless you and keep you. God bless.